open the floodgates of heaven.
Let your fire fall, let your wind blow, let your glory come down. Come on, give the Lord a shout. Give the Lord a shout. Give the Lord a shout. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, thank you. It's good. Thanks. Yeah, stand with me for a moment, saints. Just before you sit down, just stand with me. We're going to just lift that up a little bit. There's a move of the Spirit. Thank you, Lord, that in our imperfection, you work your perfection. Thank you, Lord, that in our imperfection, you work your perfection. You come for the right heart. You come for the right spirit. So right now in the Spirit, we can even lift that a little bit in the house. Just for a moment or two. Oh, just let the Spirit move upon you. For God is doing something new in you. For this cause Christ came to fill you up till you overflow. Till you overflow. Till you overflow. She da 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 da. She ka da da shite. Yada mataya mataya. Something is happening in the Spirit. Something is happening in the Spirit. Just stay where you are. Just connect with the Lord this morning. Shira bataya masendai. glorify your name, Jesus. We worship you this morning. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, we worship you. Yeah, 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 yeah. You may not understand what is happening, but there's something happening right now. Just let God do what God wants to do. God knows what you need right now. God knows what you need. Everybody in this house is at a different place with the Lord. But let God touch you. Just yield to God this morning. Just say, Lord, I don't understand everything, but I know I can feel your presence. I'm feeling something happening to me, and I just want to yield to you this morning. One of the ways you can yield symbolically in your act of worship, if you want to, is just to lift your hands up. It's a way of us reaching to the Lord and also a way of saying, Lord, I surrender. Just say, Lord, have your way with me. Even things that I don't understand, just let me allow your Spirit to come, to move and to bring healing and restoration to my heart this morning. For you are doing a healing work in your bride. You are bringing a restoration to this house and to the houses of worship around the world. That you are moving and you're exposing lies for truth. You are moving and exposing lies for truth. Some people don't want to hear the truth, Lord. But the only way we grow is to allow your truth to permeate deceptions in our lives, to permeate lies of perception and deception. Perception and deception. Perception and deception. Just allow whatever is happening to you now, just let the Lord touch you right now. For something is happening in the Spirit. Thank you, Lord. We welcome your presence. Where unity, where there is oneness of heart and mind, unity dwells. And where unity comes, the Spirit comes. Where disunity is, it grieves the Holy Spirit. So this morning we thank you, Lord, for the unity and the oneness of heart and mind in this house today. Thank you that you are the one that sets free. You are the one that makes us overcomers. No matter what we're going through, no matter what we've been through, no matter what hurt has befallen us, no matter what betrayal has come upon us, we thank you, Lord, that you are the lifter of our head, that you are the one to whom we can give glory, for you are the one that penetrates every area of our lives. You are the maker of who you made us, Lord. And so you know what we need. You know what we need. Just a little. You know what we need, Lord. We come before you, Lord, and we just bless your name. Faith is not a feeling. Faith is a belief system that comes out of knowing God, having intimate connection. And that's why Jesus died. For this cause he came. He came so that you and I would have life. Shirataya masenda. Yaradere yalamataya masetai. Just a moment more, just a moment more. There is a measuring line, just as we read in the book of Zechariah, there is a measuring line being stretched out for the church, the global church right now. There's a measuring line. And any time a church begins to grow and show the remedies of the Holy Spirit in our lives, the enemy comes. That's why the Lord's been saying, just beware. Don't be paranoid, but just be aware. become more self-aware and become aware of areas in your life where the enemy will come to sow doubt or confusion or negativity or whatever. Just keep pushing in, because these are moments where glory is coming to the house of the Lord, that we've never experienced a closeness like this before with the Lord. We've never experienced a move of God that we're about to see that will permeate the earth, that many of us have prayed about for years, that many of us have prophesied over for many, many years. And I believe it is so, so very close. And that is why the Lord is taking the bride and opening her up and removing all the impurities, so that we, the living bricks, are built and founded in purity. Not perfection, but in purity. And purity comes from seeking the Lord. Purity comes from just laying ourselves bare and saying, Lord, thank you that your blood is enough to break every chain. Your blood is enough to break every chain, Lord. And Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. John 18:37, if you can just put that up and keep the spirit, you can be seated, or if you want to. In John 18:37, it was the scene where we remember Pilate. And he's addressing Jesus. How many of you saw the Passion of the Christ? Okay. In John 18:37, we see, and you can just leave that on for a moment. Pilate is addressing Jesus and he says, you are a king then, he says to Jesus. So you are a king. You can keep it on. And Jesus answered, you say that I am a king. But in fact, the reason, somebody say, for this cause. In fact, for this cause, I was born. And I came into the world to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth, he said, listens to me. For this cause, Jesus came. What was the cause? If we think about our faith, and we look at our faith, we can see that there's something about our faith. Something that when we look at our faith and we say, why did Jesus die? Why did Jesus go through that terrible death? Why did he have to suffer that way? To be humiliated and spat on and all these things. For this cause. What was the cause? It was so that you and I could live free from the bondages of sin. That we had the power then, past, present, and future, to overcome and to break every chain that would hold us. That the chains of anxiety, the chains of stress, the chains of unbelief, all these chains that bind us, the chains of worry and struggle, the chains of poverty. Jesus came for this cause. And Jesus has called the church to live for this cause, the cause of Christ. Do you remember last week I spoke to you about the World Vision song, We Are the World? You all remember that, right? And I said how incredible it was how musicians, secular musicians, maybe some of them were believers, of course, but for the most part it was a secular vision that they came together for, to sing the song, to raise money for those that were in need. Those that were in poverty, those that were impoverished, those that had no food, basically not even food. But something stirred inside their secular hearts because we were made in the image of God. So even when we're not living for God, even when we're not living for the truth, even when we're not living for this cause, there's something in us that stirs our hearts when we see death or suffering or struggle. And they were stirred when they saw this. And they came together as a secular group of people, musicians that were exhausted. They made one of the biggest sacrifices. For them, it was a sacrifice. They weren't believers. To be flying all over the world and make time to meet together. And even after, you know, Grammys and all of this, still meet and then record till early hours in the morning when they're all already exhausted with touring and everything else. But that was a sacrifice. But they were stirred. They had a compassion and a passion, not for his name. Even though some of them may have, they had a cause that motivated them to do something. My point is, we've just sung that song for this cause. I'm living for the truth, the hope of the world. Oh, oh. Hope has found its home within me now that I've been found in you. Let all I am be all you want me to be. Because all I want is more of you. Let your presence fall upon us. I want to see you face to face. Let me live forever lost in your love. Because all I want is more of you. And then the chorus, I'm living for this cause. I'm living for this cause. I lay down my life into your hands. I don't know if we were realizing what we were singing. I'm living for the truth, the hope of the world. In you I will stand, and all I want is you. All I want is you. That's the part God wants us to get to love the Lord God above all else, and to love one another above ourselves. One sentence is the last law that Jesus left when he died and rose again and went to ascend to be with God, our heavenly parent. And it was that you love him, Jesus, above all else. And you know, you and I can't do that when we still are focused on and living for our own love, our human love, our carnal love, which is beautiful. But remember, we're made in the image of God. So even the love, as impure as it may be and as flawed as our own love may be, it still emanates from God. In the sense, I'm not saying every relationship and all of that. I'm saying love, the very concept of love. That's why there's something that stirs us. That's why there's a piece of us missing until we know Jesus. Amen. And so, yes, this is an evangelical message this morning. But we have to understand that we are not here just for some secular cause. We're not here just because we like each other. We may. We're not even here just because we love each other. We may, hopefully, in his name. We're here because there's a greater cause, and it's the cause of Christ. It's to bring the church to a place where we can be the light of the world. Don't listen to those who judge churches and talk about, you know, this church is that. And every church is going to be full of hypocrites because we are sinners, recovering sinners. People are going to say things. They're going to always do what Jesus said don't do. They're going to stick their finger in someone else's eye and Jesus says, but take the log out of yours before you take the splinter out of theirs. Are you hearing what I'm saying? So it's only through the love of Jesus Christ that you and I are able to move into a deeper place. It's only because he loved us first. The Bible says that Jesus loved us first. God loved us first. And that's why Jesus was sent into the world. Remember, the Trinity pre-existed, so you know when I say it. God loved us first and then came after us. You are not here today by chance. You are here because God loved you enough to come after you. God comes after us and we find the Lord and then we chase after God.
Yes, that's good.
I want to chase after the Lord. There's something stirring where everyone in this place is wanting something more with God. A deeper walk, a deeper connection. And the Lord wants that above all else. For this cause, Jesus came. Not for you to be the same. Not for you to live your life the same way as you ever did before. Not for you to even be the same as you ever were before. But to be ever changing and increasing into the likeness of Christ. Not because of the outer rituals you do. Not even because you come to church every Sunday. That's a must so you can sit under the word and learn how to do things God's way. But more than that, because of your heart change. Because of the inner experience of developing a relationship with Him. Through your prayer life. Through going deeper. Through hungering after the more that you know is there. We know there's something more. Even those that are unbelievers, there is a gap in our hearts, in our lives. And you know, the only one that can fill that is Christ. But we try and fill it with every other thing. We try and fill it with money. We try and fill it with Solomon said that. Should I repeat what my wife said? She's actually not unscriptural, because if you read Ecclesiastes, where Solomon began to address the youth, that's what he said. He said to them, youth, listen. Listen up. Hey, listen up. He said to the youth, he'd been around a while. And he said, listen, I've tried it all. He must have. He had 700 wives. Yo. Try and manage that household. I don't know about you, but I think one spouse is enough for us to manage. I'm thinking about my wife having to manage me, not the other way around. Thank you, Prophet. Would you like to... So Solomon addresses the youth and he says to them, he says, you know what, I've tried everything. Got 700 wives, and the one thing the Lord said to him is, do not mix your marriages. Meaning, don't marry a pagan when you are a believer, basically. What does that mean? It just simply means that when we unequally yoked, what happens is we end up either moving closer to the Lord or further away. Because we're going to want to please one or the other, right? That's why. It's for our own good, right? So it's not some kind of ritual law, or it's because God knows what we need. And so he addresses the youth and he says to them, listen, I've tried everything. Wine, woman, and song, basically. You can go read it. Book of Ecclesiastes. And he said, and you know what my biggest mistake was? Was that I was unequally yoked and it took me away from God. Now, he was the wisest man of his time. So he had wisdom. Wisest man. And it took him away from the Lord. And he said, you know what? Never forsake your first love. And that's the thing, is that the church has forgotten her first love. How many were on TNL? How many enjoyed TNL? How many experienced, when you're on TNL, how many experienced just this power surge of the presence that comes through TNL? Do you know why? Because that whole thing was brought about by the Lord. Not by me, not by humanness. I'm just an instrument of God's peace. Hallelujah. So don't, you know, it's normally we would have connect groups. We want to start our connect groups again, where we meet midweek and we come together in small groups. How many say amen? Hallelujah. Now, we're rebuilding the church, so it's been difficult to start every ministry at once, but so far you've got TNL. So if you don't come on TNL on Thursday nights, please join us at 7 p.m. South African time. That's important for us to come together. But he was saying this because he was saying we mustn't forget our first love. And the church as a whole, we've made our churches look pretty. We've got, you know, the sound systems. We've got the right songs. But our hearts have not been full. Are you with me? And we just sang that chorus, to fill me up till I overflow. And that needs to be our heart's desire. You know, our flesh can so get in the way of everything else. Why do you think we talk about it so much? Because it gets in our way. Because that's how we've lived all our lives, is in our flesh, right? In our flesh. We live in our flesh. So we're used to doing things in our flesh. We're used to making our own decisions. We don't consult the Lord. We used to, you know, this is just a way of life. We've always had to operate in our independence. We've always had to take our own steps. So now we become born-again believers, and now we're laying everything down, and we have to lay it down, and then we lay it down again, and then we lay something else down, and then we have to, oh, before I make that decision, I need to pray. I remember, I need to pray. I need to wait on the Lord. Oh, yes, the Lord brought me confirmation. Well, how much confirmation? Two or three? What was your confirmation? And so... you know, there's this whole new way that God brings us into the kingdom to understand that it's not about flesh, it's about spirit. Is the whole body important? Of course it is. I read to you Romans 12:1, that our bodies we offer to the Lord as living sacrifices. That's why the whole of us is important. It's not just your spirit being. What we do with our bodies is important. But what am I saying? I'm saying that when we're living for the cause of Christ, we come to a place in our lives, and all of you are in a different place. All of you. Everyone in this room is in a different place spiritually, but we're all moving in the same direction. See, that's all that's important, is that you're taking steps. I always say to people, as long as you're moving forward, when you stagnate, then you've got to worry. When you stay in the same place because of fear or something else that grips your heart, or there's an oppression in your life and you just don't seem to be able to break through, tell someone, speak to one of our pastors. So important for us. Are you with me? Because that place of breakthrough is right there, but you just got to know how to break down the door sometimes to get to your breakthrough. Because the enemy, as you get closer to God, then you become a threat. That's why we talk about him as the enemy. He's the devil, of course. And he is real, just by the way. I've had demons when we've done deliverance, and I'm not saying this to scare you or anything else. When we've had serious deliverance where people have been severely oppressed by demonic oppression and they've begun to manifest, I've had demons try to grab my cross. I had a gold cross that was given to me at my ordination. I've had a demon speak. This woman's voice was this most quiet little voice. But all of a sudden, this demon spoke through her, grabbed my cross. My leaders at the time who were helping me with the deliverance, they got such a fright, so did I, by the way, even though I was doing it, and said, I know who you are. I mean, you don't want to know. We've had some experiences. Now, I know for some of you that's a bit of a hard pill to swallow. Okay, you're thinking, is this real? I wouldn't lie from this pulpit. I wouldn't lie at all. Think. Of course I wouldn't lie anywhere else, but I mean, I'm just saying, especially, you don't, you know, this is sacred space. And we've had many of these experiences, so let me just tell you that the devil is alive and well, and there is a spiritual war for your soul. That's not to scare you. That's not to, but because things are unseen doesn't make them not real. So I always say to us, let's get every oppression that is pulling you down, everything that is weighing you down, get it out of your life, because it is going to blind you at some point or another. I've seen people come so far and stop because there is an oppression in their lives that has blinded them to see the truth. Once you're blinded, it's hard to see and believe anything from there. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Anybody know what I mean? Listen, he's a liar and a thief, and he comes to steal and destroy, and the Bible says he wants to kill you. That's what John 10 says. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, Jesus said. But I have come, he said, to bring you life. For this cause I have come, to bring you life and the fullness of it. For this cause I've come to bring you fullness of life. Fullness, fullness, wholeness. I want to fill you up till you overflow. I want to give you more than enough. I want to give you more than you ever dreamed or could imagine. But I have to know that you are yielded. I have to know that you want more. No one's going to give us what we don't want. So that's the place the church is at. And that's why it was so important even for us to do the song. We try and always to do songs that are relevant to what God is doing right now. This is a very old song, but it's for right now. when the Lord awoke me about that world vision song, We Are the World, and all of a sudden began to show me how can secular people without the Spirit of God, they don't even have another motivation, and they are motivated, and they are passionate, and it's not even for His name. It's not for one that bled and died for us. It's not for the, and we have a cause of Christ who not only bled and died for us so that we could have life and have every chain broken, but we have a cause that brings us into life, that brings us into fullness, not just for who and what we can be to the world, but for our own benefit as well. For us to become better people. Not because you've decided, hey, listen, I'm going to do this next time and I'm going to do that and I'm going to have a New Year's resolution. We can have all of those. But there's only a limit to what you and I can do. But when the Holy Spirit comes to live in us, and when the Spirit of God is allowed to take full control, you see, that's the difference. You have the Holy Spirit living in you, indwelling in you, when you give your life to Christ, when you say, Lord, I'm yours. The Spirit of God indwells you, but it's only activated when you yield. It's only activated when you say, okay, Lord. What we sometimes do as we're growing in our faith is we allow the Lord to take a little and then a little more. We yield a little bit, and then we yield a little more. And then we're fearful to yield too much, right? Because we've experienced betrayal, and we've experienced hurt, and we've experienced, you know, just mistrust and all of those things. And we've learned how to guard our hearts in the wrong way. When the Lord speaks about guarding your heart, it's against the enemy. It's against all the things that we've got to reverse in the world, not the things in the world that have made you guard your heart in the first place. It's guard your heart against the tactics of the enemy. It's be discerning. It's be on your guard. And so God wants to bring us into fullness. God wants us to experience the joy of the Lord being our strength. God wants us to experience what we are doing here for this cause. What does it mean to us? You don't have to operate in your flesh. You don't even have to try and do things for Christ in your flesh. You don't have to do them just because today you feel good about yourself and you're going to do it today. When you are immersed in the Spirit of God, because you don't just have for this cause. You have the Spirit of the living God residing in you. You have an activation of Holy Spirit, the supernatural power of God in you. Remember, I spoke a little bit about the anointing last Thursday. And I spoke about how there's the anointing that comes upon you in ministry, and then there's an anointing that's in you. The anointing in you is the gifts. But also, the Spirit of God indwells you, and those gifts are activated when you begin to lay yourself down and yield on different levels that God takes you to. You and I can never be authentically who we are actually made to be, because we were created with original intent. You were created with an original intention, and most of us don't even know that we're not living out that original intention. The original intention is for you to have life and life abundantly. It's for you to be on fire for God. It's for you to know your Maker in such a way that it's not about a ritual or a binding or a have to. It's about a desire that comes from within that you want more and more and more and more and more of the fire. It's saying, Lord, set a fire in my heart that I can contain and I can't control. Because God wants to change you. And when you come into a place where you're fighting for the cause of Christ, you are being changed. You are not doing it because you're doing it in your own strength or as a good deed anymore. Because remember what the book of James speaks about. It speaks about faith. Works without faith is dead. What that means is that, yes, you and I can feed the poor and we can do all those things, but it's so much harder without the Spirit. When you're doing it because you have the cause of Christ in you, you're motivated in a different way because you have the Spirit of God living in you. It's a different thing altogether. And that's what that means when we talk about works without faith are dead. The works that we do for Christ come out of a heart for God. They don't come out of a ritual or a have to or a must do. I don't come to be in practice because I have to. Maybe sometimes I might feel a bit like, ugh. But for the most part, I recognize that this is good for me and it's good for the church. And I realize, my word, I can be a vessel for the Lord. I'm giving something back. I mean, today when I went all around the keyboard, I thank God for the bass and the guitars that suddenly just took it up and messed it. And where I messed up, they just took it up. It was so nice just to have other musos to just, you know, because of course, you know, that's, I'm still learning that. Okay, so God's grace upon me. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. But we know that it's not even about the key. It's not even about how well we play. It's great to have that. It's about the Spirit inside of us. It's what's driving us. It's the Spirit of God that is driving us. That's the difference. That's what happens when you're on fire for the Lord. So what is the one thing God that the enemy wants to do? Put out your fire. He wants your desire for God to fade. He wants you to feel like, you know, your flesh is kind of ruling the roost and, I'm not having a good day today. You just have to say, get behind me, Satan. I'm in my healing process. Listen, you're in your healing process. Right now, God is exposing every lie of the enemy. Sometimes it's going to be challenging for you. I'm going to put it straight out there. There are times when everyone has that threshold. Everyone has that, you know, that, what do we call it? No, what's that? T-junction? What? Please. Huh? Yeah, a fork in the road or you come to that like T-junction. Whatever it is, okay, I can't find the word. You come to that place where you have to make a decision to go left or right. Thank you, one of those. Thank you. Oh, you all had such beautiful words. And you come to that place where you realize, hey, hang on, I've got to make some serious decisions here. So I'm not saying they're not always going to be challenging. If they weren't challenging, would it be that you change? Because remember, we're so used to doing things, we cannot authentically be who we were created to be with original intent. Yes. Until we come to that place of laying it down, yielding, yeah. Saying, God, I'm all yours. You know how easy it is? We do it, we pick it up, we do it, we pick it up, we do it, we pick it up. But God is patient and graceful with us, right? That's just because we've learned to be in control all our lives. Amen? We've got to get our minds and our flesh behind us. And we've got to let our spirit lead in the forefront. And the way you do that is how you build your relationship with Jesus Christ and Holy Spirit. And that is the only way you can ever do that, 101. And I say it because people, believe it or not, even seasoned Christians, they can fall in this area. If your prayer life is waning, your fire will wane. If you develop your prayer life, even if you have to ask one of us, how do I pray? And you begin to move into a place where you are connecting with God, it will change everything for you. And not just randomly connecting when you need something, but connecting in a way where you actually make specific time to put God first in your life and everything. That your prayer life is before anything in the morning, so that your steps can be ordered by the Lord. Many of you have had prophetic words about that. Your steps are being ordered by the Lord. But we can't say the Lord's ordering my steps if I am. That's good. Lord, order my steps, and then I step out of my prayer, and off I go on my own tangent. I don't go, Lord, which way, what? Do you know that, I know this sounds ridiculous, but sometimes I even pray for a parking space. When you travel, Lord, protect us as we go. Because you just know the Lord is ever present. You come to a place where your relationship is so real with God that you just talk to the Lord all the time. You still want specific time with the Lord. You want dedicated time, communication, and connection. Read the word, connection with the Lord. Not just you praying all the time, but put on worship music and begin to let the Spirit of God just stand up there and just worship. Just say, thank you, Lord. I just bless your name. And then you even may let some of the words of the song emanate with your spirit. You don't have to be talking all the time apart from worship. So there are different times and ways to pray, but you have to go deeper in this hour to be a part of the cause. Amen. For this cause Christ came. Not to leave you the same, not to leave you with your burdens, not to leave you with your struggles, not to leave you with the pain of loss. Listen carefully, not to leave you with the pain of loss, whatever that is for you, but to lift you higher so that you can live in the fullness of who He is. It's for this cause that He died. It's for this cause He bled. It's for this cause that He suffered a terrible, terrible death. And then the only thing you and I are called to do is to lay down our lives to sacrifice, not physical death, but to lay ourselves down in complete surrender. And the reason we talk about it so much at church is because it's the thing that people struggle with the most. Yeah. We do lay down, but we are not unconditional about our laying it down. We are conditional. We may not think so. We may go, no, but I laid it down. Apostle, I did that last week. Really? How's it going for you this week? God is gracious. And original intent is so that we can become authentically who God created us to be, each of us as individuals. Amen? Isn't that amazing? So when we think of that world vision and the, you know, we are the world song, and we think of what God did in that. I mean, did any of you go and listen to it, or did I post it or something? Did I post it? No. I shared the YouTube link. Okay. Yeah, and it's just because we've got to understand there is a cause that we don't even have to do just with our physical need and deed. In other words, it's not that you're motivated by your flesh like they were as secular musicians. We, all the more, you and I are able to do things for the cause of Christ because we have the Spirit of God. The Bible says the joy of the Lord is our strength. We have the strengthening of the Holy Spirit in us. But sometimes when that fire goes out a little bit, we start moving in the flesh, and then the cause doesn't become so exciting anymore. And that's what we've got to shift and change. We just got to change. We just got to recognize it and go, okay, what am I not doing, Lord? Okay, my prayer life's reduced. Because you know what people do, especially in the beginning? We pray, we get excited, and then we pray for a week, we feel the presence, we feel closer to God. We like amening, we even start amening, even if we didn't before. We start amening, we start almost coming into a place where when we hear the word, we start thinking, yeah, now I know why they're amening, I've got it, I'm getting it. And then we try and live off last week's fumes, and then this next week we don't pray the same way. And think that we're still okay because we're in the presence, we're in the Spirit, we can feel something shifting and stirring. You can't exist like that. Prayer is initially a discipline, but then it's something it becomes part of our lives. It's our everyday life. And it's not a sacrifice to pray. It may initially feel like that, but don't be distracted in this hour. Don't let anything take the place of your prayer life. Don't be distracted by the things around you. Don't be distracted by your workplace, by colleagues, by family members, by things that are happening in your life that are pulling you out of the circle of life. Don't let anything pull you out of the place of the fire. Don't let anything take you and distract you, because the enemy does not come except as a deceiver. The Bible says he is exceedingly deceitful. Oh, it says so many other things about him. He doesn't talk in lies completely. He talks in half-truths. That's what he did in the Garden of Eden. He didn't say to them, listen, do you know God is a liar? Because they would have said, yeah, right. He said, did God really say? Did God really say that you shouldn't eat of that fruit? Surely you will become more like God. And isn't that what the enemy does to sow doubt in our lives? Yes. Did God really say? Is what apostle said or prophet said really true? Can this really be so? Especially if you're in struggle. You're going, how will this be, Lord? You start pulling a Mary. And you know, when the angel came to her and said, listen, you're gonna bear a child and he's gonna be the Son of God. She went, how will this be? Because I am being with a man. You know what I'm saying? And the angel said, the Holy Spirit. That's another whole story about how the blood never touched the... Anyway. So what I'm saying is we have to understand the realities. If the very conception of Jesus Christ coming to earth, being incarnate, coming to earth, living his life, walking where we walked, experiencing the dislikes, the throwing of stones, the ridicule, the criticism, every other thing that he experienced as he walked, and he was the Christ. But he lived as we did. He had given up his divinity. Remember that kenosis of Christ thing. And we move into a place now where the God of glory and grace comes to earth, gives up his divinity so that we could be saved, and we're still blind to see what that actually means for us today. We still do not see the amazing thing that we have in this gift, this amazing potential that God has given us through Christ, because it said when he ascended on high, he left his Holy Spirit to dwell in every believer. And why would that be? Why would Jesus go through all that if it wasn't so that we had life now, so that we couldn't make something more of what we are? That we couldn't, because if it's just all ritual, if it's just all religious stuff, if it's just all have to's, if it's just all, well, if I go to church, God will think I'm a good person. If it's just that, then he wouldn't have even had to die. He didn't have to sacrifice his life. The purpose was that it literally became a substitution for us. Jesus died in our place so that our death, spiritual death, which is sin, didn't have to be. So in other words, he outfoxed the devil who thought that that was it. Do you remember that song that Carmen sang? Where he speaks about Jesus is in the grave for 3 days and the demons are reporting back to the devil and they're saying, oh no, he's dead, he's buried forever, he's gone. They're busy telling the devil and they're like on the phone to the devil. The demons are busy telling the devil and all of a sudden they're going, oh, what was that? Oh, what was that? And then there was a shaking. And all of a sudden they went, oh no, the stone has been rolled away. Gooseys. The stone was rolled away supernaturally. If you're living in this faith and believe in who you serve, he's a God of the supernatural. Jesus is the one who has brought supernatural life to you. You don't have to live as a dead Christian. You don't have to live as you did before you found Jesus. You have such an incredible gift given in you. The enemy doesn't want you to see what you are and who you will become. But I'm telling you today, there is so much more. God has so much more for you. But there will be challenges to be everything you are called to be. Because there are things that we want to not want to give up. There are parts of our nature and our personality we're not willing to negotiate with. And there's coming times where you get to that crossroad where you will find you have to make a choice. Will you make a choice for his cause? Will you begin to live in the purpose to which you are called? Will you begin to take seriously who you are and what a difference you can make in the kingdom? Because most of us don't see ourselves. We've got this bad self-image. You can be as good-looking as you like. You can still have a bad self-image. Hey? You can think, listen, I'm quite good-looking and still have a bad self-image. What's the other word? Not self-image. A low self-esteem. And the Lord wants to lift you up and show you exactly who you are and the potential you have. That you can see that for this cause, this is a cause worthy. This is a cause worthy. It's worth the sacrifice. It's worth the moving forward. There's a small sacrifice and a small price we pay. When I first came to the Lord, I'm ending with this. We can just bring that on a little bit. I remember I had a lot of friends, people coming in and out of my home. I was also a musician, so it was like a railway station. Parties, all those things. And then when I gave my life to the Lord again, I recommitted my life. I'd done that when I was 10 and I backslid because I thought I couldn't be gay and Christian. And I went through all of that because my dad was a pastor, those of you know. And I was like, when I gave my heart to the Lord again, the Lord just cleaned me out. And it wasn't like someone said, you can't do this and you can't do that and you're not allowed to do this and you're not allowed to. It was that my eyes were opened. And there were just things that I didn't want to do anymore. There was just parts of my life I wasn't that weren't a priority anymore. Because I had been changed on the inside. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Will you stand with me? That's what I'm talking about for this cause. Never to remain the same. 2 Corinthians 3:17 and 18. If you can just put that up as a last scripture for me, Lisa. 2 Corinthians 3:17 and 18. Thank you. Read it with me. 1, 2, 3. Now the Lord is Spirit. 1, 2, 3. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is
freedom.
There is
freedom.
There is
freedom.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Keep going. 1, 2, 3. And we all who with unveiled faces contemplate the Lord's glory are being
transformed.
Into God's image with ever increasing glory, which comes from the Lord who is Spirit. Our faces have been unveiled because when Jesus died, and most of you know this, the moment he actually died physically on that cross where he gave up his spirit, no one took it from him. He gave up his spirit. Do you know that the curtain that separated the Holy of Holies in the temple was torn in two? The sky was darkened, there was an earthquake, and the temple curtain was literally physically torn. And it was a place that no human being could access except the high priest in the Old Testament. And he would go there once a year and sprinkle blood from the offering, the animal sacrifice, onto the mercy seat, which was the Ark of the Covenant, which represented the presence of God. That was in the Holy of Holies. Now, I want to tell you, there are some Christians that live in the outer court of the temple and they want to stay there forever. There's some that will live in the middle court and go to seeker-friendly churches and say, that's okay for me. I'm living a nice, shallow faith. I like it this way because I'm still in control. I like it this way because I do my own thing. I like it this way because I can live in my flesh. Well, then you might as well just say there's no cause. Because Jesus never came to leave us the same. Jesus came to bring us into a place of transformation. Living transformed lives for our better so that we can be who we were created to be. That's the cause Christ came for. Not just to rescue us from sin and spiritual death, but to take us higher to a place that we've never been before. And if the God of the supernatural can do all that, do you not think God will do what God has said God will do in your life? Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. The Bible is clear. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to God, the heavenly parent, the Bible says, except through him. I think it's John 14:6. So take seriously what God has put in you as a believer today. And understand that there's so much more for you. Will you take it? Will you become one who wants to live for this cause? Will you become one who stops seeing yourself as less than? Will you become one who takes yourself seriously enough to believe that you are part of the living bricks, part of the house of the living God, one who can make a difference, one who can usher others in, that you begin to take seriously that it's for this cause that Christ came to give you a better life, for you to live a better way, for you to have the freedom that you need and joy unspeakable? Come on. So right now, just very quickly, all we want to do is just if you say, Lord, I want to go deeper this morning. I want to go deeper. I want to embrace a deeper walk with you. I just want you to come up here. We're going to lay hands on you very quickly, and we're going to speak over you in Jesus' name. Just come up quickly. Don't wait. If that's you, just come up. Say, Lord, I'm going deeper and higher. If there's anybody here, before we call you up, if there's anybody here and you've never given your life to Christ, you've never made a commitment, an actual commitment to say, Lord, be Lord of my life. I want to change the way I live today. If that's you and you've never done that, just lift your hand up as the heads are bowed. If there's anybody here, if you've never done that and you want to do that today, you want to say a prayer to lead you into that place where you give God permission to rule your life. If that's you this morning, just lift your hand up. Hallelujah. Okay, so come up right now. If you're saying, Lord, I want them all. I want that fire. I want the glory to come upon my life in a new way. Just come up. Don't be afraid. Just come up right now. We're not going to spend time. We just want you to come up. Come up right now in Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Jesus' name. Right now, in the name of Jesus, I want to anoint your head with this oil. And I thank you, Lord, that every chain is broken right now.
Yes. I break those hurts. I break the dominion of darkness. Third and fourth generational curses over your life.
Thank you, Jesus.
That have kept you in bondage, Zion. That have kept you from seeing. The Lord sees your commitment. And ha'urra bakatea, I speak right now full restoration and healing over your life.
Yes, there you go.
That you be touched and you just let God do whatever God needs to do right now in your life. Because I see in the spirit that you be laying things down before the Lord that you haven't laid down before. There are burdens that you've carried, that you've kind of almost, you know, carried them, but they've been there for so long that you didn't even like it was so normal to carry them. But the Lord said those are not yours to carry. Those are not your burdens. And right now, I just set you free from those burdens right now in Jesus' name. And even as you've done that, I just lift this up. Even as you are joined to your mother by blood.
Thank you, Jesus.
I want to break every third and fourth generational curse.
Yes.
That is taken through the bloodline, that it stops right now, right here in Jesus' name.
Yes, Lord.
And I seal you with the blood of the Lamb. And I resist, I say, the devil is resisted. And I command every lie of the enemy, every demonic force that is trying to perpetuate your life, I break the cycle right now. Mind, body, soul, over you. I say every oppression, the enemy knows what God wants to do with your life. So I break every oppression right now and I seal you in the blood of Jesus, both you and your mother, right now. Oh, and I also, sorry.
Let's just stretch out our hands. Let's also just receive this ministry. Let's impart. And let's just come into agreement with what the Lord is doing with people. Thank you, Lord. Onliners, let's just raise your hands. Put in the comments if you have a prayer need. If you have a need that the Lord needs to bring deliverance, just put it down because the Lord is going to do what the Lord needs to do as we stand in agreement. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes.
Like even I know there's a parent's love. I understand that. But this is a supernatural love that God is giving you for your son and your son for you. Right now. We break every chain, every hold, every stronghold that has tried to bind you. Even in the past, even third and fourth generational curses are broken now in Jesus' name. The Lord says, no longer keeping anything in, son. Can I have somebody here? I release you from every bondage, every lie of the enemy. I set you free. I close every door now. And I release you in Jesus' mighty name.
Yes.
Free. You're free.
You're free. You're free. You're free in the name of Jesus.
You're free. You're free. Broken in Jesus' name. Every bondage. Now. There it is. We got you.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
We set you free in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Ooh. Thank you, Lord. Oh. Come on.
Apostle, original intent is being restored over you, Sheldon. Original intent. I was so struck by that. Original intent. We've lost our original intent, but the Lord is showing you, revealing to you what original intent is for you. Thank you, Lord, that you are bringing revelation to this man. Thank you, Lord God, that you are showing yourself to him. I thank you, Lord God, that he will seek you in a deeper way, in a mightier way, that the glory, Lord God, will shine from him and upon him. Ooh, Sheldon, original intent.
The Lord is showing you what the Lord can do when you put God first. The Lord said, son, your steps will be ordered by me. And can you see, as you follow me with all your heart, how your steps will be ordered by me? For I am the King of glory, and there's nothing impossible for me, says the Lord. Right now,
receive that. Refreshing. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Now, some of you may not understand what's happening. There's nothing radical. This is what Jesus did as a matter of course. As he walked the earth, he cast out demons, demonic forces. It's not to make you fearful or anything. So please don't get all freaked out. If you don't understand, just ask one of our pastors what this is. Simply, it is just breaking our bondages from things that hold us captive, things we don't always see or know. Are you with me? Does that make sense? And when people fall out, you all understand. Nobody's pushing anybody. The Spirit of God and the power of God is just coming over them. And God will do what God will do. Hallelujah. It's all good. In the book of Acts chapter 2, when the Spirit of God came upon the church, those 120 in the upper room, you'll remember what happened. All those onlookers and the critics stood around. And the apostle had to go to them and say, listen, they are not drunk as you suppose, because they were falling all over the place because of the Spirit, the power of God. They're just filled with the Holy Ghost. And then he goes on to talk about the prophet Joel, and he says, this is that which the prophet Joel has prophesied, what I have said. And what we are seeing in the book of Joel 2 is coming to pass now. We've prayed for it for many years. We're going to see people. We're going to see miracles, signs, and wonders, both in the physical, emotional, and spiritual in this house. And that's why God's preparing us. For this cause Christ came, that you may never be the same. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Yes. Hallelujah. Amen. Please enjoy some tea and coffee and fellowship with us. We bless you in the name of Jesus. God bless you, onliners.